Morning. Welcome to the Broadway Baptist Church live stream. My name is John. I'm very excited that you have chosen to join us today at Broadway via the internet. I'm the kids pastor here at Broadway Baptist Church, and I just want to take a moment of your time and let you know what our kids are going to be learning about all through the month of March. Now, this month, we're going to be taking a look at five instances in Jesus's ministry that give us an example of how God wants us to live. We're going to start out in the book of Mark in chapter 2 when four friends lowered their buddy through the roof to see Jesus because they couldn't get in through the crowds. And from that, we're going to learn that people can ask Jesus to take care of their friends, of their family, of other people. After that, we're going to go to the book of Luke, and in chapter 10, we're going to be taking a look at the story Jesus told of the Good Samaritan. And what that story is going to teach us is that there are specific things that we can do to be more like Jesus. In week 3, we're going to stay in Luke chapter 10, but we're going to move forward a little bit and look at the account of Mary and Martha. And from Mary and Martha, we're going to learn the choices that Jesus wants us to make, and we're going to learn that we can honor God when we make good choices. In week 4, we're going to move ahead to Luke chapter 19 and the account of Zacchaeus. And what we're going to see is that we can follow Jesus's example when we obey God. And finally, in week 5, we're going to go to the book of John in chapter 4, and we're going to meet a woman at a well. And what we're going to learn from this woman and her encounter with Jesus is that God has a plan for every single person. I'm really excited to be spending this time in the Gospels with our kids this month. I cannot wait to dig down deep and to really get to what Jesus is teaching us and sharing that with our kids. Thank you again so much for being a part of our service today via the internet. We are so excited to have you here. If you enjoy what you're watching and what you're hearing, why don't you give us a like at the end of this video? If you want to see more services like this, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you always want to know when we go live, just hit that notification bell. Thanks again, and we look forward to seeing you on our campus very, very soon. Have a great Sunday.
It was working earlier.
Based around Jesus Christ, that truth that he gave to us. Let's sing together.
You came for criminals and every Pharisee. You came for hypocrites, even one like me.
You carried sin and shame.
You carried sin and shame, the guilt of every man, the weight of all I've done, nailed into your hands.
Let's sing this, church. Oh, your love. Oh, your amazing grace, I've seen and tasted. Let's sing.
Oh, your amazing grace, I've seen and tasted it. It's running through my veins. I can't escape its rhythm. In you, my soul is saved. You cover
us alive again. Amen. Let's sing together.
Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin, who takes away our sin.
The Holy Lamb of God.
The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again, makes us alive.
Let's sing that, church. Behold the Lamb of God.
Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. Who takes away our sin.
The Holy Lamb of God.
The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again. Makes us alive again. Came to see
fire. May that be our prayer this morning. Let's sing. So let your name.
So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher,
be lifted higher.
So let your name be lifted higher,
yes,
be lifted higher, be lifted higher. Jesus coming to this world and living a sinless life, going to Calvary to be sacrificed for my sins, being buried and raised again on the third day. And Lord, thank you, Jesus, thank you that you're at the right hand of the Father, even now, making intercession on our behalf. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness and your grace each and every day, the new mercies that you give us. Lord, now we pray that as we've worshiped you in song, Lord, that we may worship you with our giving. Lord, may we give more than just monies that all belong to you. Lord, may we give our hearts and our minds and our souls to you wholeheartedly. Lord, may we give of ourselves this morning. God, I want to lift up our pastor as he comes and opens your word. Lord, may he have a fresh anointing this morning to preach what you've laid on his heart. Lord, may he be totally obedient to you as he opens your word. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness. Lord, we thank you. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
When I gaze, good to be here this morning, and so thankful to have the opportunity to continue with our series, The School of Prayer. If you've got your Bible, I want to invite you to open it up to the book of Colossians. This is number 4 in the series. We've had a couple messages from the book of Ephesians and then the book of Philippians, and this morning, the book of Colossians chapter 1, learning how to pray as we just sort of follow in the footsteps of the Apostle Paul. This morning, we're just going to try to walk through a brief prayer of a very, very powerful prayer that Paul prayed for the Colossian believers. Colossians 1, beginning with verse 9. Chapter 1, beginning with verse 9. The Apostle Paul writes, "For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we haven't stopped praying for you and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you may have great endurance, patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of His Son, the Son that He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." It's a great, great passage. Father, in Christ's name, help us to understand what the Apostle Paul was praying, and help us as believers and students of your word to really deepen our own prayer life as we walk through these brief verses, this actual prayer that was prayed hundreds of years ago for believers. Help us to grow and help us to mature in this discipline of prayer. God, we need that desperately, and I know it's your will for every member of your family to be a prayer warrior. And so we ask in faith that you'll speak to us now and transform our lives, transform our prayers. In your name we ask all of this in faith. Amen. Now, this particular prayer by the Apostle Paul contains 143 words in the New International Version. In the King James Version, it's 132 words. In the New Living Translation, 171 words. And if any of you have an Amplified Bible, that version comes in with a whopping 223 words. And like so many other prayers that we see from the Apostle Paul, it's really one extremely long sentence. Really, it's incredibly long. You call it a run-on sentence. It's filled with words and phrases and clauses that just seem to pile on top of one another. And even though the NIV breaks it down into three sentences, it really doesn't help us very much. Paul packed a lot in these 6 verses. If you read this prayer out loud, it takes about a minute. And I'm sure that this particular prayer that's been recorded for us is more like a Reader's Digest version, in which Paul gives us a summary of a prayer that could have been a lot longer. You could take any phrase in this prayer and build an entire prayer around it. This prayer is actually filled to overflowing with spiritual, life-changing truth. Now, I'd like to try to make sure that we don't get lost in the details and miss the main point. And let me give you a very simple outline. Are you ready? This prayer contains one request, one main request, one purpose, and 4 results. Got that? One purpose, one request, 4 results. So let's look at the request. Paul basically offers up one basic request, and you find it in verse 9 if you lift that key phrase out and you hold it up for a closer inspection. He's asking God to fill the Colossians and to fill all of us, really, with the knowledge of God's will. Now, that little phrase, it forms the heart and the soul of this entire prayer. He wants us to be able to learn or to grow in the knowledge, to be filled up with the knowledge of the will of God. Paul is praying for the Colossian believers, and he's asking God to give them wisdom and spiritual insight so that they'll know God's will. Now, that's very practical when you stop and think about it. Almost everyone I know has come to some point in their lives where they were, quote unquote, looking for God's will. You've been there. And most of us think about God's will when we sort of hit the intersection of some major, major decision in life. For example, where am I going to go to college? That's a big decision for a young person, and high school graduation is just around the corner, and so many students are considering and making those final decisions. Where am I going to go to college? Or the search for the right job. That's a major decision. Here's a big one. To whom will I get married? Who's going to be my wife? Who's going to be my husband? What church will I attend? Another big decision, buying a home is a massive decision, or a job offer that may require a move from where you're currently living. I mean, that's massive. Or maybe going to the mission field, or investing your money, or having children. How many children do we want to have? And the list could go on and on and on. And these are all legitimate applications of the will of God. But I think Paul actually has in mind here something a little bigger, deeper, and broader when he uses this phrase. And I think the key word is the word fill. Fill. In its basic form, the word means to be filled to overflowing. It means to be engulfed. It means to be overwhelmed. It means to be fully possessed or controlled or somehow to become the dominating influence in a person's life. If someone's really, really scared, we say, man, I was filled with fear. Or we might say, I was overcome with fear. Have you ever been there? If someone is really just out of their mind, mad or angry, we say, woo, that guy was filled with what? Rage. He was filled with rage. Or if we meet someone that's just so kind and generous, we say, oh, that person is just filled with kindness. They're just such a sweet individual. So the concept is, if you're filled with the knowledge of God's will, here's what it means. You want what God wants for your life. That's the driving passion of your life. You really, really live with this motivating desire to want what God wants. And in so many ways, it's a very challenging standard. Oftentimes we pray, Lord, your will be done. And we pray that without ever really considering what those words really mean. Too often, and I mean way too often, we mean something like this. Lord, show me your will so I consider it to see if it fits in with my plans. Let me just say, that's a prayer that God will never answer, because God never offers his will for you to consider it like it was some type of invitation to have lunch next Thursday if you happen to be free and if nothing better comes along. God doesn't reveal his will to us to be considered. He reveals his will to us that it might be done. Your will be done in my life means something like this. Lord, let your will be done in me, whatever it costs, whatever it takes, wherever it leads. Lord, your will be done in my life means, Lord, your will be done even if it means my will never be done. It means, Lord, let your plans go forward even if that means I radically change my plans. To say, Lord, let your will be done implies a huge spiritual truth. It means that God has a will or a desire for your life. Have you ever thought about that? It means that God has an agenda for your life. It means that you also have a will, and you also have a desire for your life. And finally, when you pray your will be done, you're actually asking that God's will take precedence, take priority over your plan, your will, your desires. Praying your will be done means letting go of your own life. Sometimes we refer to that as dying to self. Paul talked about dying daily. He didn't die physically daily. He died to his plan. He died to his agenda. He died to his will, his way, his desires. When we pray, Lord, let your will be done, we're dying to self. And it's hard to pray that prayer because it means that we're giving up control of our lives. And let me just say that for most Americans, that is a very difficult thing, to give up control of our lives. Now, it doesn't mean that your life goes out of control. It just means that you surrender your life to the control of God. Let me just say that's a great place to be. Now, when we do that, that leads to some very practical questions. Like this, do I want to know God's will so I can consider it? Or do I want to know God's will so I can do it? Am I willing to be engulfed with God's will? Am I willing to be dominated with God's will? Or do I just need some help in making a tough decision? Am I ready to love what God loves? Am I ready to go where He sends me? Am I ready to obey what He tells me to do? Am I ready to suffer if suffering is required? Am I ready to wait? I mean, listen, some of us would rather suffer than wait. Waiting just can be so difficult, but am I willing to wait if that's what's required? Am I willing to endure when that's required? Am I willing to rejoice when that's required? How about this question? Have I agreed with God in advance that I'll do His will even before He reveals it to me? Am I willing to say yes to God's will and God's way even before He makes it known to me? Now that's a great place to be in life. How about this? Will I take the daily small steps that are right before me while I'm waiting for the big steps to be revealed? So often when we say, Lord, I want to know your will, what we really want is the big, exciting picture. We want the big, grandiose assignment. But God never usually takes us from point A to point Z. He usually takes us from A to B to C to D. It's small steps. And am I willing to take the small steps of daily life and be faithful where I am and do what God's called me to do right now so that one day I can reach that massive plan that He has for my life? Here's another question. Do I fully understand the will of God is more about who I am on the inside than where I am on the outside? I want to say to you, I believe that is crucial. So many of us get wrapped up in geography about where I am on the outside when really, most of the time, the will of God has to do with where you are on the inside, the interior man, the interior woman. But where are you with Christ today, this morning, right now? Finally, am I ready for my life to change if that's what needs to happen? Am I ready for my life to change if that's what needs to happen? See, this is the heart of the prayer, that we might be filled to overflowing with the knowledge of God's will so that we want what God wants for us and we want to do what God wants us to do. Got it? Secondly, Paul has one purpose in mind in this prayer. I really believe that. And this purpose is the necessary result of being filled with the knowledge of His will. And this purpose isn't possible without coming to the place where we're really willing to say, Your will be done, nothing more, nothing less. And we find it expressed this way in verse 10. Where Paul says, and we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please Him in every way. Every way. It's a bold statement if you think about what it really means. Look at the word worthy in verse 10. It comes from a root that means heaviness or weightiness. It seems to imply value. All of us, if we're honest with ourselves, from time to time, think about our own value, our worth. I mean, we're not going to live forever, and I think we want to know, was my time on planet Earth worthwhile? Did I matter? I don't want to squander my life. I don't want to squander my opportunities. I want to know, and most people want to know, did I make a difference with someone, somewhere, somehow, at some time? Each of us, again, if we're honest, has personal failures, more than we like to admit. We have hidden areas of sin, areas where we're still not exactly where God has called us to be and wants us to be. We have some areas where we would say, that's a failure in my life, or I have some things that I doubt. There's some areas where I'm compromising, and see, we're the only ones that know all that stuff. We may put up a good front, but deep, 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 well within our lives, we know that we're far from what God has called us to be and even what we really want to be ourselves. Sometimes those feelings of self-doubt may overwhelm us to the point we wonder, why should I even try anymore? Why should I even get out of bed today? Why should I try to, you know, be on that pilgrim's progress where I'm growing? I feel so defeated. But in this particular text, in this prayer, I believe God calls us to something incredibly exciting. Paul prays that we would walk worthy of the Lord so that someday we could actually hear him say, child, I am so pleased with you in every way. I mean, that's exciting when you think about living that kind of life where we're walking worthy. We're living up to the standard that God loves us, he saved us, he's filled us, he has sealed us with the Holy Spirit, he's revealed his heart and his plan for our lives, and because of all that love and all that grace and all that mercy now, we're not walking because we're being forced to, God not holding a gun to our head, we're not under the burden of the law, but because of the sweeping grace, mercy, and love of God, we're trying to live a life that's worthy of the Lord and pleasing him in every way, so that one day we'll hear him say, oh, you pleased me. Good job. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. We need to understand that doesn't happen automatically. We need to think carefully about what we believe. We need to understand that we've been fully accepted by God, that we've actually been adopted into God's family, that we've been blessed. The scripture says we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing already. We're not waiting to receive those. We've already been blessed and seated with Christ in the heavenlies. There is in a very true sense in which God Almighty, on this very day, at this very moment, is already pleased with us because we're united by faith to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and God is fully pleased with Jesus. Amen? In other words, when God looks on my life and when God looks on your life, he doesn't just see Tim Lampley or he doesn't just see you. He sees us covered, washed, robed in the blood of Jesus Christ. And now the standing of Christ becomes our standing, and we're saved and made righteous, not because of anything we've done, but because of the finished work of our Lord Jesus on the cross. Jesus lived a perfect life. He died a substitutionary death, and when he rose from the dead, he defeated death, hell, and the grave. And when we put our trust in him, listen, we become adopted, and we get his status. His standing, and that means in a very real sense, because God's pleased with Jesus, he's pleased with us. Kind of like this. A parent is easily pleased when their son or their daughter is trying to achieve and do something. And how many of you have had a child in any type of music recital? Raise your hand. Any type, piano, clarinet, trumpet. It's amazing to go to one of those things. And you sit there as a parent, you're just on the edge of your seat for your child. And then you just sort of endure everybody else's, because they're, especially in those early, early years, I mean, let's face it, the kids are learning. And let's say if you're a parent, your child may be playing the clarinet or the trumpet and may miss 10 out of 11 notes, and you're just beaming with pride going, man, that's my boy, that's my girl. They're making progress. Everyone else is wincing, but mom and dad are saying, I'm just so proud. Well, that's the kind of family pride that comes from just being in union with that family member. But then there's another sort of pride that comes when that son or that daughter, through years and years of hard work and dedication, accomplishes some really major goals. They graduate from high school with honors. They get a scholarship. They go to a great university. They excel either academically or athletically or in the arts. And you know, they're great citizens, and they just model everything that you've wanted them to model. And there's that sense in which, oh my goodness, they have worked so hard. They've really disciplined themselves. They're bringing such honor to my family and our name. And that's exactly what Paul has in mind here when he says he wants us to be able to walk worthy. It means that you and I are to live so that God is pleased with us. Not in some overarching manner because we're united with Christ, but because he sees us every day laying ourselves down and saying, it's not my life, it's not my will, it's not my agenda. Oh God, I want to be filled with the knowledge of your will so I can pursue it and pursue you. I want that to be the thing that engulfs me and dominates me. I want to excel for Christ. We leave behind that kind of testimony, that kind of story, and we've got to be willing to pray, Lord, your will be done in my life. And no strings, no conditions, no special deals. I give you my life. Now, Lord, you do with it as you please. When we want what God wants, when we surrender our will and our agenda, his purpose becomes our purpose. Our lives will be dramatically changed, and we'll find purpose. We'll find meaning in everything that's happening to us. And life becomes more an adventure than a drudgery. And when that begins to happen, our lives begin to take on this sense of joy, and we're visibly different. And we become eternally significant because we're achieving the will of God. And the Father, Abba Father, is pleased with us. Wow. Wow. That's the purpose. Look at the results. We'll just be brief here. There's so much. See, the remaining verses, the last part of verse 10 through verse 14, actually involves four results that follow from walking worthy of God and living that kind of life that's pleasing him in every way, or we might say in every detail. First, we'll live a life that bears fruit. Verse 10, look what he says, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work. So here it's the fruit of good works. In other places, we understand that word bearing fruit to mean the bearing the fruit of godly character. There may be a little bit of both here, but specifically, bearing the fruit of good works. Being involved with the things that God's involved with. Henry Blackaby used to say, find out what God's doing and then just join him. When you do that, you'll be involved in a life that begins to bear good fruit in the area of works. Secondly, he says when we're pursuing the knowledge of God's will, where there's no strings attached and no deals, we'll begin to live a life that grows in the knowledge of God. Look at verse 10 again. He says, growing in the knowledge of God. That's more than just growing in theological knowledge. That means more than just having a catalog of scripture that you can recite. It means more than knowing some attributes of God or details about God. This is really speaking about knowing God intimately. And that involves all the things I've just mentioned, but so much more. It's one thing to know about someone. It's another to know that someone. A deep, deep, intimate knowledge of God. Third, in verse 11, Paul says, we'll begin to live a life that endures, demonstrates endurance in hard times. Look at verse 11, where he's praying that they'd be strengthened with all power according to his glorious strength or might, so that you may have great endurance and patience. When you're living that kind of life where you're pursuing the will of God, you're going to need to be able to wait. You're going to need to be able to endure. There are some things that are going to come into your life, cross your path, that will be completely distasteful, that will be utterly difficult. And if you don't have that ability to endure, you'll fade, you'll give up, you'll quit too early. One of the results of really pursuing the knowledge of God's will is an amazing sense of growing endurance and patience. And finally, verse 12 through 14, Paul says he's praying that they'll live the kind of life, and the result will be giving thanks continually. Look what he says. He says, being strengthened with all power according to God's might, so that you might have endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father, who's qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. He goes on in verse 13 to remind us, you've been rescued, you've been saved from the dominion of darkness, and God has brought us into the kingdom of his Son, the Son that he loves, in whom we have redemption. And he defines redemption, that's the forgiveness of sins. Now when you stand back and you look at this amazing way to live, a life filled with good works, a life that's continually growing in the knowledge of God, a life that has a growing ability to endure hard times with joy, and a thankful spirit that all that God's done for you, you start thinking, man, that's the kind of life that I long for. So here's the prayer. Paul prays that we might be filled up to overflowing with the knowledge of God's will. So that means, again, yielding our agenda, yielding our plan for his, so that ultimately God's purposes become ours. Think about that. When that happens, our lives radically change from the inside out. I mean, we're setting out to please the Lord in everything, in every way. Suddenly, you and I, whether we even realize it, become difference makers in the world. We're involved with God's agenda, which means we're doing more than just taking up space on the planet until we die. Our lives are filled with purpose and meaning, and we have a reason to get out of bed in the morning because we're linked up with God, we're part of his kingdom, and we're doing his work on planet Earth. And all of it, Paul says, comes because of Jesus Christ. See, here's the good news. He gave us an inheritance, so we know we have an incredibly bright future. Jesus says, I've taken you out of darkness so you can see things clearly now. Paul prays and reminds us we've been made citizens of his kingdom, and now we have everything we need because we're members, we're citizens of the kingdom of God. We've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb so that we know with certainty our sins have been forgiven. Sometimes if you're watching a special program on television, it'll say this program has been sponsored by, and then they'll name some big company, GM or Exxon. I was starting to think about how they underwrite all of that, and we get the benefit sometimes of a great special on television. Maybe this should be added at the end of verse 14. This prayer, prayed by the Apostle Paul, made possible through Jesus Christ, because all that we have comes directly from him. I pulled out an old book in my library this week. The title is Wild at Heart Wild at Heart. It's by John Eldridge. It's a book about the search to discover the true purpose of a man's life. Toward the end of the book, Eldridge relates that while he was rummaging through a bookstore, his life was changed by two sentences in a book that he just happened to pick up. And he says those two sentences were so insightful, he didn't read another word. He writes, "I sat the volume down without turning another page. I walked out of that bookstore to find a life worth living." Those had to be two pretty powerful sentences. You seeing the picture? He picks it up. He reads two sentences. He lays it down. He leaves the store determined. "I want to find a life that's actually worth living." This is what he read in that book. Don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive, then go do that. Don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive, and then go do that. Because what the world needs is people who have become fully alive. I like it. What makes you come alive? What makes you come alive? What makes your heart rate speed up? What makes you passionate? What thrills you? What drives you? What is it that makes you come alive? And it's right here that Paul's prayer sort of hits us right between the eyes, because for too long, and I mean this, most of us have thought of God's will as being sort of boring, dull, negative, tame, and really something more akin to homework in algebra class. You have to do it, but you don't have to like it. And we just couldn't be more wrong. To be filled with God's will, the knowledge of God's will, means that we're finally free to come alive. It means to be filled with God, and to be filled with His will means we're finally free to fulfill our God-given destiny. To be filled with God's will means we're free from the tyranny of following the world's plan or the others that are around you, their plan for you. To be filled with God's will means that we're free to risk everything for the sake of Christ and for His glorious kingdom. If you ever decide to seek God's will, your life may become many things, but it won't be boring. See, that guy was right. The world, our world, needs people who have become fully alive. And I guess I'd simply add to that, the world needs people who've come alive through the gospel of Jesus Christ and the knowledge of God's will. And that is a perfect description of the people who pray this prayer in Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. Through verse 14. "For this reason," Paul says, "since the very day we heard about you, we haven't stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of His Son, whom He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." Let's pray. Father, we desperately need to be the kind of people, men and women, the kind of young people who want your will to be done in our lives more than anything else. And Lord, we pray with the Apostle Paul that we would have a growing knowledge of the will of God for our lives. That our purpose in life would be to live a life worthy of you, pleasing you in every way, pleasing you with every detail of our lives, that we might experience those blessed results that we talked about this morning. God, forgive us for thinking too often that the will of God is boring, dull, religious, uneventful, sometimes even unnecessary. Forgive us for not allowing you and your plan and your agenda to engulf our lives. God, I pray you'd raise up a generation of young people who have a growing, passionate thirst and hunger to have a growing knowledge of the will of God and then the courage to pursue it. That you'd free us from small objectives. That you'd stretch our imagination. That you'd let our hearts ache with the things that break your heart. And let our hearts thrill with the things that cause your heart to be thrilled. That we'd love what you love and hate what you hate. We'd love you with our heart, our soul, our mind, and all of our strength, and love others as we love ourselves. That we'd finally determine to be the kind of people that live lives that make an impact with others and on others. None of us in this room want our lives to be insignificant. We really want to know that we've mattered. Somehow, somewhere, at some time, our lives made a difference, a real difference, in someone else's life. Help us today to grab hold of this prayer and to begin to pray it with conviction so that we might become the men and women and young people who experience everything we've talked about this morning. I'm grateful you're not playing hide and seek. I'm grateful you say that when we ask, you answer, and that you're willing to reveal to us great and mighty things that we don't know if we'd simply be willing to call out on you. Make us men and women, and make us young people who hunger to have a growing knowledge your precious will. Then, oh God, give us the grace and the courage to do your will, to walk worthy, to live worthy, to please you in every way, for the glory of your name and your kingdom. That's how we pray, in faith. Amen. Look this way. A lot of young people here today, a lot of young couples, a lot of median age adults, some senior adults. Does it ever become convenient to not have to worry about the will of God? Do you ever reach some stage in life where that sort of becomes a non-issue? I don't think so. Every season in your life and mine is a new opportunity to serve Jesus Christ enthusiastically. Nobody can say with any type of genuine conviction, I've paid my dues, I've done everything God's called me to do, I've done everything He's asked, and now I'm just sort of on vacation until I die. No, that's not how it works. Whoever you are, wherever you are, listen to me. God has a plan. God has an agenda, a will, a desire for your life, and He wants you to connect with it. He wants to show you. And after He shows you, He wants to empower you according to His strength, the strength of His glorious power and riches. He wants to set you on a path of becoming a difference maker. Are you willing this morning to pray that prayer we talked about at the very beginning of the message? Oh God, your will be done. Your will be done. not so I can consider it. Lord, your will be done, period. No strings attached, no deals. Your will be done. I want to become that kind of individual. And when we pray that prayer, our lives begin to change. When a church community like Broadway, or any other church for that matter, begins to collectively make that their heartbeat, the church begins to change. And then people's lives outside the church begin to change, because we're no longer concerned about some of the other smaller, petty issues that we've been so wrapped up in previously. We begin to live lives that extend outside of ourselves and our small interests. We begin to see people so differently. We see them with the eyes of God, and we love them with the heart and the love of God. And we begin to relate to them in the power of the Holy Spirit. And life becomes an adventure, and it becomes exciting. Exciting. Don't you want that for your life? I've been praying in a very fresh way. God, show me your will for this season of my life, where I am right now, based on everything that's happened and where you've brought me and where you've brought my wife and my family. Lord, I want to know in a fresh way your will. And I'm actually still praying, Lord, show me in a more clear way what makes me come alive. I want to pursue that. I hope you'll join me. The beginning step is to know Jesus Christ. If you've never repented of your sin and just simply put your faith in Christ alone, you've got to do that today. There is salvation in no one except the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says we've all sinned, we've all blown it, we've all failed in so many ways. But if you're willing to confess your sin, your failures to God, just say, I'm placing myself at your feet, and today, I believe that you're God's son. I believe you came from heaven. You lived a perfect life. You died on a cross, not for any crimes you committed, but for my sin. And then you were buried and you rose from the dead. And I just know that you're God and you have the power to forgive. Come into my life. Change me. Forgive me. You start calling the shots. You make that commitment of your life. That's step number one to a life of becoming more intimately aware of the knowledge of His blessed will for your life. Stand up. Stand up. Father, in Jesus' name, give us courage right now. If there's even one individual in this room that's never trusted you as Savior and Lord, I pray today they would turn from all the substitutes. Turn from all the temptations. Turn from all the voices that are telling them they can put it off until a more convenient time in their lives. I pray that today they would turn to you in believing faith and be wonderfully, radically saved. That you'd make them a child of God, a part of your forever family. And then for those of us who already know you, oh God, how I pray that we'd be consumed with this idea, this concept, this truth of yielding our lives and our will to you. Oh, I pray that as individuals and as a church family, all we become more and more knowledgeable of your precious will, so that we would begin to desire to live the kind of lives that are worthy of Jesus and please you in every way, in every detail. For the glory of your name. That's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Today, if you'd like to come and speak with one of us, we're available. If you just need to come and kneel and pray, maybe you've been wrestling with the will of God, and maybe today God's revealed to you, you've just got to turn loose of some things. God's will is not for you to consider, it's for you to do. You must be willing to say, not my way, your way. Not my will, your will. Be done. Not considered. Be done. Maybe you've got a child or a loved one that's really going through a difficult time, trying to find their way in life and trying to seek out God's plan, you just want to come in prayer, you need somebody here to pray with you for them, we're available. Maybe you need a church to worship and pray and have fellowship and be encouraged. If God's telling you, I want you to become a part of this faith family, we'd love to tell you how that can happen this morning. We'll wait a few moments as Brandon leads us in a time of reflection and commitment. If God's spoken to you and you need to make some type of public commitment or decision, we're going to wait a few moments for you. You come.